Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here at Prophetic Evangelism. Thank you so much. This conference is stark, fresh fire. I trust God that before the end of this convergence, each and every one of us is going to be infilled again and infused again with another dimension of fire. I trust God that by the end of this convergence, we are going to return back as flames of fire burning for the Lord. The true definition of a believer hides upon his ability to continually burn for the Lord. Every believer that does not burn for the Lord continually does not really have an expiring date. He has actually expired. The currency that we use to do business with God is prayer. But the evidence of your continual prayer is your consistency in burning for God. Any believer that is not burning for God consistently has actually lost his true definition of the manual of his operation. The true definition of what grant unto us strength in the spirit is not how much we know. Everybody knows something. In fact, you cannot be as cool as a CRS professor. In fact, you cannot know Bible so much as somebody that has studied CRK in the school. But it is possible for you not to know too much, but to burn more. And by the privilege of burning a lot, you discover that you can do more for the kingdom. All through time, Christianity was advanced by the burning infant of men. Men were consistent burning for the Lord day in and day out. While they were eating food, they were burning. While they were traveling, they were burning. What made them to continue to testify about the kingdom was because they were burning. The testimony of the act of the apostle was a moving of an infant of people that became like a flame of fire. Because they became like a flame of fire, the evidence of the effect of the flame of fire is defined in their life. Anytime a fire begins to burn, the influence of the burning of fire is radical. It's a pandemic that can never be stopped. We speak about COVID-19 right now, but the inferno of the flames of fire that burn in keeping to kingdom standard can never be hindered. The advancement of the kingdom of God is by fire. Until the fire of God comes upon the life of a believer, the believer can do nothing for the kingdom. And until the fire of God is found in a region, found in a city, found in a country, found in a territory, God will look as though God is dead. The only thing that makes God alive is that God is moving by men that carry fire. I trust God that this night you can be able to contain sufficiently much as I will give definition. Most time the problem is, the first problem when it comes to ministration, number one, is utterance. The ability for the minister to actually be ministered to by God. Because until you are ministered to by God, you cannot minister unto others. Another challenge is the inability of the people to sufficiently have enough capacity to be able to contain that which God is ministering. Everybody is a stammerer when it comes to kingdom business. Everybody does not know how to speak when it comes to the counsel of God. We speak as we are aided by God. The same way with prayer, as much as the strongest of the person you see that can pray actually need help to pray. The reason why he prayed the way he's praying is because he actually was helped enough. That is to let you understand that whether you like it or not, when you come to kingdom business, no man does it by the arm of the flesh. Everyone is a stammerer. Everyone is handicapped. Everyone has a lot of infirmity that can always want to superimpose him when it comes to spirit-enabled communication. And that is why we require the help of God to be able to engineer us and ensure that an unction is granted unto us. And by the privilege of that unction, by the privilege of that utterance, we can be able to speak the counsel of God. And everyone that speaks the counsel of God is one that is aided by God. The Bible speaks in the book of Romans 8. It says, we do not know how we should pray as we ought to pray, but the Spirit of God helped that our infirmity with groanings that we cannot be able to utter. Prayer to us is tongue. Prayer to us is shouting. Prayer to us is all kinds of syllables of tongue. But according to scripture, the Bible said that prayer is actually the degree of the help that comes by groaning. That sincerely speaking, you truly really begin to pray when you have come to the end of speaking in tongues, and now you can begin to groan. And in the point of groaning, you don't even know what you are saying, because now you have been helped to pray. It's the same way when it comes to ministration. When it comes to ministration, ministration has switched from normal communicating to people's mind to spirit administration. And anytime a man cannot administer spirit unto others, he's wasting their time. Jesus Christ speaking said, the word I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. They have the ability to communicate life and also to be able to impart a spirit. Because the problem of mankind is that a spirit is given unto them that is not the spirit of the triumph. A spirit is given unto us to them that does not actually align to God. Man was born with a fallen state. The spirit that man has is fallen. As a result of that, that lacks the ability and the potency to connect to divine realities. So God needs to engineer his spirit, and by the engineering of his spirit, his soul receives life. Then by the life received upon the soul, then his body can now be able to be immortalized. And the immortalization of the body gives him transformation to be able to represent God effectively well and not be hindered by the power of the flesh. The degree to which man represents God lies upon the capacity of his spirit and how much more he is able to transcribe God. The transcription of God upon his spirit grants advantage to his soul to be equipped with the sufficient knowledge, then grant his body the privilege to be immortalized. The immortalization of his body gives him expression to divine realities by the sustaining of eternal life. The sustainability of eternal life granting the privilege not to be limited upon the face of the earth, because a life superior than mortal life is given unto him. This can only be possible when a man is helped by God. The degree to which God helps a man is the degree to which he supplies his spirit to him. Ezekiel was upon among many people that were captives by the river Kaba, and suddenly a spirit was supplied. The Bible speaking said, while he speak unto me, in Ezekiel 2 verse 2, he said, a spirit enters me and set me upon my feet. By the supply of the spirit of God, suddenly Ezekiel was said to be different among the cadres of all that were captive. Yet he was among them as captive. But being part of the captive by the supply of the spirit became their leader, became a prophetic and an apostolic voice that they have to hold on to, because now he's speaking like God, and God cannot be held captive. Yet Jesus Christ was crucified. He was buried. He was actually put in dungeon. But immediately, where he was put that looked like a disadvantage became an advantage the moment the spirit was entered. Immediately the spirit came upon him, something happened. The supply of the spirit grant Jesus Christ the ability to be able to break through the grave. When you go to that grave, you can never be able to come up. But immediately when the spirit is supplied, where you are become actually an advantage, because that is actually a place that God can be glorified. So whatever we do in the kingdom, we do upon the strength of the supply of the spirit. We do upon the strength of the resources of heaven. We waste the resources of heaven. We waste the supply of the spirit of God. And consistently, as we continue to waste that resource, we build the body of Christ. We edify the body of Christ. We activate the heart of men. We activate the spirit of men. We shift them into alignment. We fine-tune them to the current disciplines and the discipline and the operations of God. When a man begins to speak by the unction and the utterances of the spirit, him himself need to submit himself to that which he's speaking, because he doesn't know what he's saying. He said, the word I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. You cannot be able to understand a spirit. You only walk according to his dictate in obedience. We are demanded to obey the spirit because we cannot be able to understand him. By faith, the Bible says we understand. Not by understanding, we have faith. That is to say, when it comes to the operation of the spirit, you walk with him by faith. Then that faith that you walk within defines your walk in obedience, give you an understanding according to divine patterns. And that patterns gives you landmarks and gives you pathways which defines your walking with him over time. And these are the things that define the operations and the encounters you have in life according to the degree of the grace applied to you. Oh, before we go too high, I need to be able to make certain basic acknowledgement. I realize I forgot to acknowledge the people that have labored over time before this. Please help me appreciate Reverend Janita, a woman of prayer. Help me appreciate Watchman Bry, Watchman Tawanda, Apostle Peters, Prophet Enns, Divine Joseph. I think Donor Abba is also in the group. He's also in the house. And also help me appreciate Joshua and each and every one. I think Envoy also, right? And each and every one that is present, that has actually been laboring so far. I trust God that we will be able to do justice some few things. The first thing I need to understand is the necessity and the need for the supply of the Spirit of God. You must be able to understand that every believer is handicapped in this kingdom to the degree to which the Spirit of God is not supplied to him. Anytime you want to have an advantage in the Spirit, what you need first of all is the Spirit of God being supplied to you. Your life will truly change from the very onset, from the very beginning, when the Spirit of God is supplied to you. Anytime God wants to change the life of a believer, what he does is that he supplies his Spirit upon him. And when that Spirit is supplied, the first thing that happens is this. The man begins to realize that all the things he called himself was a lie. all through time, he does not really know who he is. The supply of the Spirit of God restore you back to the original template from where which you are created. The Bible is speaking in the book of Jeremiah. He said, Jeremiah, before you are born, before you are conceived, I knew you, and I ordained you a prophet unto the nations. But all through the life of Jeremiah, it will surprise him to know that he was never really called a prophet by his mother or his father. What actually defined him to be called a prophet was the supply of the Spirit of God. It was because of the definition of who he is in God. Yet I always say, we are the sons of God. As much as we are the sons of men, many more times we think we are the sons of men. Good as you are the sons of men, you are actually the sons of God. As good as your parents love you, they don't even know who you are. They just give birth to you and give you a name. But your true definition of who you are lies in God. Until you be able to know who you are in the mirror image of God, you have not known yourself. Everything you call yourself is a lie. I realized, it took me time to really realize that I was trying to live my life according to what I planned and not according to what God planned. God will always change your plan. Why? Because anytime you see God in the mirror image of who he is, you actually see a divine mandate, a divine plan that you have no understanding of. At consistent basis, as you continue to journey with him, what happens is this mandate is unfold. For instance, you are giving birth to a family of six. And what you do not know is that there is a family in the spirit that you belong unto. And until you begin to pray, you now begin to have encounters in the spirit. Begin to see other people. You begin to find yourself among a tribe, among a clan, among a quorum of immortals, among a quorum of people that are beings, among a quorum of elders. And you begin to ask yourself, these people, they know even more than your parents. They even know more than your siblings, because they begin to teach you. They begin to educate you. They begin to talk to you. They begin to impact you. They begin to transact things with you. When you begin to have encounter, you see yourself in Nigeria. You see yourself in US, you see yourself in Dubai, you see yourself in UK, and you begin to realize that far beyond the city that you are, your encounters are actually transgenerational. Your encounters are are beyond continent. Your encounters are beyond cities. Your encounters are beyond the terrain, the physical terrain that you are in. Why? Because as much as important a man is localized within a region, the spiritual content of a man is actually global. The spiritual component upon a man is cosmic. The spiritual component upon a man is what contains the DNA of the operation, of the blueprint of the manual that wherewith God has called him. And until you understand who you are in the mirror image of God, you may never be able to understand anything in keeping to your purpose. Every prince in this kingdom must know his gate. As you begin to journey as a prince, you must understand your gate of authority. You must understand your gate of advantage. Daniel knew his gate. Meshach knew his gate. Shadrach knew his gate. Esther knew her gate. Deborah knew her gate. These people knew that. Samuel knew his gate. Samson knew his gate. That is why they know where to stand. They know what to do. They know how to do it. Balaam and Balak know their gate. They know what to do to conjure things. They know what to do to manipulate things. The understanding of your gate of authority, you will grant you the privilege to be able to know how to influence things in the spirit. Because until a man is strong in the spirit, he's weak. Until a man is weak in his flesh and strong in his spirit, is weak indeed. Until a man has stature in the spirit, no matter what stature he has in the physical, it's a waste of time. One of the greatest challenges we have in the body of Christ is our definition. Many of us are trying to define ourselves according to the parameters of the flesh. I'm telling you the truth, you can never be able to define yourself outside of the mirror image of God. Many of us have tried to look for who we are in books, who we are in sermons, who we are by motivational speaker. The challenge is this: motivational speakers empower your mind. I get what I'm saying now. Only God activate your spirit. Only people that have been made living witnesses come to administer spirit and life unto you. Motivational speakers will motivate your mind. They will tell you you can jump from a cliff, but by the time you jump from the cliff, you now discover the law of gravity is stronger than your motivation. Motivational speaker will tell you that you can start up a business with zero naira. They do not really understand that according to the law of economics, you don't create out of nothing. What told you? Who told you that God created out of nothing? No. There are actually resources available and tools available for creation. When God was creating, the Bible said, God said, let there be light. If God did not speak light, he couldn't have created. The Bible said the Holy Spirit was hovering all around before God said, let there be. There was the Holy Ghost in creation. The Bible said when God was creating, the morning stars were singing unto creation. What does that tell you? There were angelic beings were actually releasing their possibility into the foundation. The Bible said by wisdom and by power. That is saying that there are actually what we call intangible resources for creation. So you don't create out of nothing. Motivational speaking is in vacuum. When we talk about spirit administration, we talk about the possibility that lies in the spirit. The Bible says God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The blessings of God are in Christ Jesus. These things are actually existing. That you cannot see it does not mean it's not existing. It's just like me saying, because you cannot see oxygen does not mean that oxygen does not exist. There is a blessing of God. The supply of oxygen is a reality, that there is something that exists. So somebody will tell me he's not breathing anything. No, you are breathing some, you are spending oxygen. Until the day you cannot take advantage of oxygen, when you go to the hospital, you're not beginning to realize that as cheap as oxygen can be, it's very expensive. The same way with motivational speaking, they neglect the tool of creation and they tell you can create in vacuum. No, there is no vacuum. Spirit occupies every vacuum. You must understand that nobody rises without the supply of a spirit. The same way when it comes to God, there must be a spirit supply to you for any creation to happen. The Bible speaking, let us understand that everything we see that is created today was actually created for what we cannot see. But that is created for something we cannot see does not mean that what we cannot see is not really existing. You may not see God with your physical eye, but actually God exists. But you can experience God. You can encounter God. The same way you need to encounter who you are in the mirror image of God. And that is only possible when God supplies himself to you. I told you, God can never be taught. God can only be revealed. All the teaching of God you have listened to every time, even the one I'm talking to you right now, is a waste of time. If God did not reveal himself to you, everything I'm saying right now will fade away. The mind of man is not designed to retain anything. That is why you can read as many things as possible. As you go to the exam hall, you forget it. You can read your Bible from cover to cover for 10 years and you can amount to nothing. Until the spirit is supplied, your life will still remain a wilderness. The spirit's supply is the difference to everything when it comes to kingdom agenda. Until the spirit is supplied, the spirit is the hard disk. The spirit is a storage capacity which sustain every reality of God. When you look over through time, men could not contain God. God came and walked with them. God came and walked through them, but God cannot dwell inside of them. The challenge was that the spirit of God was not poured upon them from on high. Until the spirit was poured from on high, they could not be begotten as sons of God. Yet they were representative of God. Yet they were prophet of God, speaking by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Ghost could not dwell inside of them. Why? Because the spirit of God has not yet tabernacled bodily inside of them. Until the spirit of God tabernacle in a man cannot host God. The hosting site of God is the spirit of God. Until the spirit of God is tabernacle inside of you, you can never know God. That is why many people today, they are good Christians. In fact, they are so morally right. They have never slept with anybody. They have never smoked. They have never drank. They have never insulted anybody. Yet they don't know God. The reason why they don't know God is nothing. It's just because they don't have the capacity. They don't have the software. They don't have the hosting site. They don't have the conduit for God to dwell. So when God comes, God will see them worthy a vessel, but he will pass by them. The reason why God is passing by them is because there is not a place he can tabernacle. They are not sufficient enough a capacity for him to dwell. Why there may be somebody that is drinking and smoking, and yet he has desired for the supernatural. He has desired to host a spirit. And because of that, one day the Lord encounters him. And immediately when God encounters him, God can dwell. What I need you to understand is this. God is always willing to dwell upon a man that can host him. The challenge is, can we really, really host God? And the only thing that can make us to be able to host God is when we carry the spirit of God. And that spirit of God, when you carry him, you must learn to exercise him. If you don't exercise the spirit of God, there's a limit to which of God you can carry. The Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word spoken by God. Do you realize that all of us are product of a spoken word? All of us are product of an utterance. All of us are product of speech. Do you realize that all through your life, whatever you are today was because men spoke to you? The first day they gave birth to you, they began speaking unto you. You too, you were speaking, you were crying. When you went to school, you were mentored, you were guided, you were spoken words to. You became a chemist because they spoke words in keeping to the knowledge of chemistry. You became a biologist because they spoke words in keeping to the knowledge of biology. You became a medical doctor because they spoke words in keeping to knowledge of medicine. You can also become a lawyer if they actually spoke certain level of words that are govern the body of truth of legal practitioner. The same way, you can become an engineer if we concorded word appropriately right that deals with engineering and continue speaking unto you. You study words, and words build you, and words form the structure and the foundation of who you have become today. The same way, that you study spirit, you study physical word, and you became who you are, you must also be able to yield yourself to every word spoken by God, if you must become everything that God has spoken. God is still speaking, but the agency of the speaking of men right now is through men. The Bible speaking said, holy men were inspired as they wrote. All the scripture you see today was actually the speakings of God through men. Many more times God passed through men, spoke through them, and as he speak through them, it was documented. If we are in the days of Bible, in the days of the Bible days, do you know right now what we are speaking now will be another episode? All the preachings we have been preaching will be another episode, because a generation will come and read what we have been speaking, and they will have encounters with God. Not because of anything, but because God inspired us to speak those things. And every inspiration that comes from God releases a facet and a dimension of the deposit of God. And every dimension of the deposit of God are like letters. They are like building blocks that are required to ensure that a believer is built appropriately right. The speakings of God carry strength. The speakings of God carry power. The speakings of God are creative. The speakings of God are potent. And until you hear the word of the Lord, there will never be enough structure within your spirit to be able to contain God. That is the reason why many more times we have had men spoken to us several times, and yet we are failing in life, because God has never spoken unto us until Jesus appear and tell you, I am sending you as an apostle. I am sending you as a prophet. I am sending you as an evangelist. You will never beg again. I will prosper you. You will never die again. You see, until that word comes to you, life does not come. Immediately when the word of the Lord comes to you, life comes. You can hear things from people. You can be excited as you live there. Every strength of it will fail away, but every speaking of God comes with power to back it up. And that is why anytime the Lord speaks something to a man, no matter what you do, a man that receives a word from the Lord can never be discouraged, because the strength of the word builds the foundation. But anytime a man does not receive a word from the Lord, it will fail away. The strength of how much more you burn for the Lord is how much more the word of the Lord you receive upon your spirit. We do the things we do today, not because people are doing it, but because there's a burden upon our heart, fashioned by the supply of the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord that came to us came as an encounter. That encounter fashioned a burden within our spirit and guide our life according to a pattern of obedience. That spoken word of the Lord ensured that everything that looks like darkness die. Everything that looks like weakness die. Everything that looks like a challenge die. I was a drunkard, I was a smoker. I never intend to be a believer. I never intend. But one day, Jesus appeared to me. The appearance of Jesus, he spoke certain words to me. As he spoke those words upon me, light emanated me. Immediately when light emanated me, suddenly I saw myself burn with fire. As I began to burn, I saw the things that looked like my challenge. That pornography, that lust, that addiction, that anger, I saw them burn in a flame of fire. Because everyone that God wants to do business with, what God intends to do first of all is to put them within a coal of fire. That coal of fire purifies their tongues. Until your tongue is purified, you cannot be given access to the utterance and the unction of the Lord. The purity of unction and utterance comes upon the lives of men that their tongues are purified. That is why Isaiah had been prophesying all through his life. All through his life, he had been prophesying until chapter 5. Immediately, when he encountered the beings of holiness, when he encountered the beings of the glory of the Lord, when he encountered the cherubim and the seraphims, coals of fire, everything he think he knew that defined his calling was tested by fire. As it was tested by fire, he now realized that he has been a liar for all through his time. The same way you can be anointed by God, you can be called, you can be preaching. People can be convinced, yet your life does not have the testimony of fire. The reason for the fire is for us, personally, so that it can purify us, so that it can burn us. Because the tendency of darkness in every believer is too much. Because of that tendency of darkness, we must continually burn with fire, so that the challenges that looks like challenges in our flesh can be tamed. The taming of our flesh comes by how much more we burn with the fire of the Lord. The reason why we pray, the reason why we fast, is so that we can tame everything that looks like the flesh, so that we can stock our spirit. Our spirit can become enough conduit tubes, having sufficient capacity to be able to carry God. Because until we carry God, we carry the devil. If you don't host God, you host the devil. Neutral does not exist in this kingdom. Neutral only exists in your physics. In this realm of operation, there is no neutral. You are either hosting God or you are hosting the devil. Why? Because men are actually like conduit tube. You must carry something. Something must flow through you, because nature never abhors a vacuum. You will see a lot of people, they will tell you, I'm not serving the devil. I'm not serving God. No, you are serving the devil. In fact, your own is more worse, because you don't even have a will of your own. You have been superimposed. Many of you here have tremendous calling of God upon your life. God has called you to do diverse things, but you lack the strength and the energy to do it. In fact, you are still doubting the speakings of God and you are looking for confirmation from men. Why? Because God has never spoken to you. Let me tell you, if God speaks one word to you, one word, you will find yourself crying every day. I know one of our friends many years ago in campus, that guy was living a very bad life, doing all he wanted to do. All we have been praying is that God encounter this guy. One day, the Lord encountered him. This guy moved everywhere preaching the gospel. From one hostel to another hostel, from one class to another class, from one market to another market. In fact, he needed not to go for evangelism school. Many of you have attended many evangelistic school. You have attended many school of ministry, yet you are not practicing the things that you have been taught. The simple is that no God, no word has been spoken unto you. Ezekiel said, "Why he yet speak unto me? The Spirit enters me and set me upon my feet." Anytime the word of the Lord come unto a man, it set the man on action. The reason why you are still waiting is because no word has come to you. You are still surviving by bread alone. The bread may be every revelation anybody is giving unto you. The day God speak to you, you are not waiting for perfection. The day God speak to you, you move by the obedience to God. You don't need the confirmation of men. Let me tell you, left to men, you are not qualified. Who instituted school of the ministry? Who instituted Bible school? As good as Bible school are, is a weak parameter to gauge the strength of a minister. That you have doctor of divinity does not guarantee that you are a man of strength in the spirit. No. There are people today that I have never attended any school of ministry. Or even if I have never been attended anywhere. I have attended a lot of school in the spirit. I have joined classes with generals of faith. I have joined classes with elders of faith. If you understand the advantage that lies in the spirit, you will never actually dare. You will never actually desire to even attend any school in the physical. If for me, if you spend 4 months attending a school in the spirit, you become an elder in the spirit. But it's possible for you to spend 30 years going through a seminary school, attending one Bible school, and yet remain a babe in Christian journey. In fact, you are going to be part of the people that will fight the move of God. You will fight the revivals of God, because the movement of God has been known to be hindered by religious men. These are the reasons. Simple, because they know too much than God. Many people, because of the bogus nature of how much more they know, they keep on ever learning and never come to realization of the truth. Men that realize the truth are men that the Spirit of God is supply upon them. You will now begin to understand that God will move with us, not because we know, not because we are perfect, not because our doctrine are right, but because our heart is seeking and searching. Our heart is desperate. Our heart is burning. That a flame burn around us. That because as a witness of fire, God moved beyond the limitation of our flesh. God moved beyond the limitation of what we do not know. And he does many wondrous things. Check through the life of all the God's generals that once upon a time live. What you will see in their life is that they had God. They had one word from the Lord, which was enough for them to move with it for many years. You told me you see a cherubim. You told me you see a seraphim. You told me you now realize, and yet you are masturbating. Yet you are a liar. Yet you are a pornographer. Yet you are a fornicator. Yet nothing has been activated in your life. What encounter did Isaiah have? Immediately when he had that encounter, something changed. Saul was a chronic sinner. Immediately when he had that encounter, on his road to Damascus, he encountered the Lord. The Lord slapped him upon the horse. When he fell, he said, "Saul, Saul, why art thou persecuting me?" He said, "Who art thou, Lord?" He said, "You cannot kick against the bulls." He now begin to let him understand the definition of his calling. From that moment, his life changed. How comes we have been having encounters with the Lord and our life has not changed? From that moment, Saul did not need the confirmation of men. From that moment, he became a preacher. Let me tell you the truth. Men are supposed to actually represent God upon the strength of their encounters and upon the strength of the spoken word of God. Not upon the strength of the wisdom of Bible school. Not upon the strength of the wisdom of somebody told you no. If the Lord has spoken unto you, then the strength of the Lord and his spirit will back you up. But if men speak unto you, men will have to back you up, and men will not always be there. Men in themselves need help from God. Many years ago, the Lord appeared to me. He said, "Philip Cephas, a man I help is always better than a man that help himself." He said, "You can never help yourself sufficiently enough." Those years, you don't know. Those years, many years ago, men were happening in our cities. That time we heard about Chris Devon. Chris Devon came with a chance. He came with a sound. We rushed to him. We heard about what Pastor Chris was doing. We rushed to him. We heard about what Bonke is doing. We rushed to him. Anytime we hear about what people are doing, we rush to them. Until the Lord told me, "Philip Cephas, these men are men that I have helped. These men are men that I have groomed. These men are men that I have hired in myself." He said, "For you to walk in their path, you must learn to actually follow their ways. But do not follow the things they do. The things they do will never teach you actually what I taught them." He said, learn from their stories. As you hear their stories, he said, you hear their secret. When you hear their secret, exhaust it to the end. One of the secrets I found out is that all of these men are men that pray. There was a point in their life when they were nothing. They began to pray. God began to help them. Also, I realized another thing, that all of these men were men that God spoke unto them. So you hear Paul Enetche say he had an encounter with the Lord. You will hear David Oyedepo say he had an encounter with the Lord. You will hear Idahosa say he has an encounter with the Lord. Everyone I take, all of them have an encounter. And I realized I was the only one that does not have an encounter, and I was pushing God up and down. And I realized I will never meet God until God encounter me. What do? I shut down. And many of them said they went through 5 days fasting. They went through 3 days dry fasting. They locked themselves for so days. They did that. Then the Lord spoke unto them. Now they are preaching, sharing revelation, doing miracles, doing signs and wonders. And I was thinking it was because God just loved them. No. And I realized that they actually had a point in their life when they were locked up with God, and God encountered them. And I begin to seek my own encounter. Immediately, when I begin to lock myself and not just keep on seeking them in the flesh, Jesus began to appear to me in my room too. He began to appear to me in my room. And I realized that God is not a respecter of persons. God only respects people that are hungry and desperately seeking and searching for Him. It does not matter how a sinner you are. It does not matter how much you are disadvantaged. Whether your pastor is a smoker, whether your pastor is a drunkard, whether your father and the Lord have betrayed you, whether you have been sleeping around by... As long as you can lock yourself and return back to the Lord, God will appear to you. God will come to you at that your disadvantaged situation. And immediately, when that encounter happened, my life was put on course. Then I begin to journey into the Spirit. I begin to meet these people in the Spirit. And I see myself begin to do business with them. I can see myself going for evangelism with Paul Enetche. I can see myself doing things together with Bensi Dausa. I now begin to realize that far beyond just meeting them in the flesh, I can meet them in the Spirit. And as I meet them in the Spirit, when I came out from that encounter, strength and power was evident. And I realized the need for me to return back. That it was actually in the secret place that men were helped. The strength of David was not in the public place. It was in the secret place. The killing of Goliath was not a practical. He has done the practical in the cave of Adullam. In the cave of Adullam was what David was doing the practical, and nobody was seeing him. Immediately when he came and faced Goliath, it was evident that he has actually been helped by God. And he knew that at this point, yet God has helped him. Now God will help him more further. The Lord told me, Philip Cephas, a man I help is always better than a man that help himself. He not made me to realize that men do not make men. It is God that make men. That in this economic system of the kingdom, it is until that a man has a signet of the help of God, a man can never bear relevance. And I realized that over through my life, I thought men could help me. I thought my father and the Lord could help me. I thought my mother and the Lord could help me. I thought my pastor could help me. I thought my mentors could help me. I thought the people I was following could help me. And I realized that we are so many following many of them, and yet many of them became nothing. I had to isolate myself from all the charlatans you are following them, and how much I want to be identified with them. And I begin to seek the Lord, who cannot be found in public places. I realize while I begin to pursue the Lord that the secret place was a place that is too secret that average people can never know. The secret place is a place too secret that normal men can never be able to understand. While I begin to seek the Lord in the secret, I begin to encounter the Lord. I begin to have much more encounters I could not share. I find myself not saying many things I'm encountering, because saying them look as if I'm proud. Saying them look as though many people look at you and say, are you okay? Why? Because encounters are not things you tell people. Anytime you tell somebody you encounter, one of the things that will happen is this. The person, if he doesn't worship you as a God, he will actually look at you as a heretic person. Either way, it's not good. What you do is to ensure that you bring men into the same dimension. And how do you do that? By activating them to do the same. Teaching them what you do. If I pray and I encounter God, I will let you understand that that is the same thing you have to do. The same way we encounter God is the same way you must encounter God. I didn't encounter God by men laying hands on me. Yeah, they lay hands on me, but let me tell you the truth. They have laid hands on many other people. They did nothing with it. After the hands came upon me, I did something.